personally.
Thank you very much again for the opportunity to be here. And as you know, the spread is a new pathogen in a pandemic situation. Always depends of three main factors: the biological characteristics of the pathogen, of course, the host responsiveness, and this is very important because for many reasons SARS-CoV-2 is versatile in relation to the host. And the third factor, very important, is the environment. Environment understood as the density of a susceptibility population in terms of climates, isolation, age, comorbidity, or socioeconomic factors. All these are very important in a pandemic situation like this. At the beginning of this new disorders, COVID-19, what is clear that the infection resulted in at least four distinct phenotypes, including people asymptomatic patient with no symptoms, people with mild or moderate symptoms, people with severe forms of the disorders, and people with critical symptoms and very 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 severe form of the disorders. But even in children with the COVID-19, in a small group of cases, what is impressive, the presence of multisystem inflammatory syndrome, very similar to Kawasaki disease, very down in this as aspect, as you can see here in this slide. But not least, that in some cases, it's very interesting to observe some phenotyped manifestation, such as COVID tos, pernio, and the COVID tos manifestation. This is a new phenomenon of pernio-like lesions that have been associated with coronavirus diseases infection. This confirms that COVID-19 represents a constellation of clinical condition ranging from asymptomatic patient to malignant and life-threatening people. Probably this is an effect of the very complex virus-host interaction that include at the moment the situation of the personal situation of the immune system, the presence or absence of comorbidities, age, hypertension, like as Alessandra stated before me, obesity, diabetes, asthma, and others. The microbiome, a very recent paper demonstrated the influence of these particular genomes in COVID-19, and of course, genetic factors of the host. Many genes have been identified, and as you can see, as a co-editor of the journal Human Genomics, I and my co-editors decide to publish in the website of the journal an update of the human genetic susceptibility genes in an updated version that is available online in the website of the journal. This reports the number of genes identified, allele of course identified, associated with the different forms of the disease. The percentage of this figure represent the number of papers of the literature that describe the role of this allele, of these genes involved in the COVID-19. As you can see here, we have many genes belonging to some particular pathway, regulation of gene expression, and in particular, innate immune system, the adaptive immune system, virus uptake, virus egress, and in particular, interferon pathway. We decided at the beginning of 2020, in April, to start with a new consortium involved and coordinated by Jean-Laurent Casanova in Rockefeller University in New York to focus our attention in particular to look at the monogenic or diagenic inborn errors of immunity. These are rare or common severe form of COVID-19. Therefore, based on our previous experience, we just focus our attention in particular in this pathway and these genes and this and the protein coded by the genes. And the approach we use is to study the patients, of course, in Europe, but in other parts of the world, and which include the whole genome exome analysis and predict rare and loss of gain function mutation identified in particular immune pathways, including interferon and others. Therefore, we started with the biochemical and other functional analysis in order to define and to establish the genotype-phenotype correlation. This is very important in this type of disorders because it's very recent analysis demonstrated that many alleles considered rare and pathogenetic on based on algorithm at the functional test are completely neutral. Therefore, it's important to start with functional tests when we identify a particular allele. And in particular, as stated before, we just looked at these circuits, interferon circuits, which is very important. It is the first line of defense in front of a virus, a bacteria, or other. This is the immune response, the first line of defense before antibody generation in others. This involves many genes activated by a very complicated signaling cascade leading to transcription of type 1, type 3 interferon genes that are very, very active in, as you can see here, in antivirus response. It is clear at the moment, and this is very confirmed by many, many papers, that untuned antiviral immunity in COVID-19 has been demonstrated at the present. COVID-19 patients exhibit impaired and delayed type 1 and type 3 interferon production. Yet, strong pro-inflammatory response are induced. Well, this is in sharp contrast to flu, in which expressed type 1 and type 3 across the spectrum of the disease severity. This untuned antiviral immunity in COVID-19 may underlay incidence of pneumonia and the critical illness observed in particular cases. In fact, we just looked at a very large number of people, very selected by the groups, by the consortia, and compared the genome of life-threatening people with asymptomatic mild positive people, but asymptomatic. This is very important. This is the control for us. And the control in these two groups, we were able to identify in 3% of these very severe people the presence of mutations in particular genes, as you can see at TR3, ILF7, ILF9, and others. This is what published last year on Science. And this is the list of the genes and allele we identify and the ancestry and the residence of people we study using this particular approach. What is important that all allele we identified were verified and very validated in terms of functional properties. In fact, as you can see in this particular slide, we verified the impact of these mutant alleles in terms of functional response when were cloned and expressed in recipient cells. And for all alleles, we identified the patient, we confirmed the functional incapacity to respond, to stimulate of innate response. But recently, we also published an additional results in which we focus our attention in particular genes described also by Professor Ranieri before, is an X-linked recessive TLR receptor deficiency in 16 kindreds. You can see it. This is the pedigree in which is a very classical Mendelian disorders, and this is a very stimulating for me that can get a significance of from a complex disorders like COVID-19 to a monogenic disorders. This is very interesting in terms of the new genetics we just discussed. These genes, we are able to address our attention in order to verify if other deleterious alleles are present in men with critical COVID-19, studying all genes on X chromosomes, and you can see in the slide in the square A, in which you can see the solved level in which TLR7 is present, and for the other, no significance variation were detected. Also for the other genes in this circuit we studies, all for all mutation identified in this group of patients, we were able to start to try functional analysis. And all this confirmed the important role of the mutation allele, particularly in these disorders, to identify that this mutant allele were causative of the disorders. And in addition, mutation in TLR7 are present in 1%, okay, of the patient. Therefore, we have 3 and 1 about 4% of very severe cases of COVID-19 show a present mutation in the genes coding for protein active in interferon pathway. But in a subgroup of patients in which no mutation in the gene were detected, we were able to identify the presence of autoantibodies to type 1 interferon in about 10% of cases. Therefore, if you put together people with mutation in interferon genes related, 3-4%, and people with autoantibodies, 10%, you have about 14-15% of patients affected by severe form of the disorders in which interferon is involved. And this for us, it's very, very important. And this result was considered one of the most significant results in the science discovered last year. A summary of this important results are presented in this slide. As you can see here, about 20% of people hospitalized with severe COVID-19 had high or intermediate levels of autoantibodies to type 1 interferon. Autoantibodies were also found in another 18% of people who died from the disease. In contrast, people with no or mild symptoms had very low levels of these autoantibodies. Therefore, in total, autoantibodies may account for 20% of the total fatal COVID-19 cases. This was recently stated by NIH in a report in which described this result, suggests that it's very important that we need to start with a screening of the presence of autoantibodies in the plasma of a patient affected by severe form of the disease in order to start with the treatment, specific treatment or preventive measures. And some mutation of this pattern of inborn errors of immunity were also detected in children affected by multisystemic inflammation. This is very recent data that confirm the importance of this cluster of genes and pathways in these disorders. The question is, can these results in terms of host genetics help us in making a drug for COVID-19? This is the question. And based on our results, some people suggested, in particular in France, that the plasma exchange could be a good therapy for people carrying autoantibodies against type 1 interferon and life-threatening COVID pneumonia. And other people suggested that a therapy by interferon beta in a patient with incontinent epigmatitis, genetic disorders in which you have a similar phenotype, a phenocopy, if you like, of this, and autoantibodies against type 1 in the infected SARS-CoV-2 could be useful because interferon is available. It's very easy in order to obtain it for treatment in an intramuscular injection or a subcutaneous injection. Therefore, inhaled interferon, this could be, and many clinical trials are now activated based on this result. But other suggestions come from specifically from my lab, screening the genes involved in the virus egress. We were able to identify people affected by severe form of the disease in which very rare missense mutation in particular genes involved with coding for protein, involved coding for ubiquitin-free ligases, a class of enzyme very active in apoptosis, virus egress, and other pathways, were very interesting because were present in this particular group of patients. This class of enzyme, it's very active, as stated before, in many biochemical pathways, including cancer, neurodegenerative disorders, and as you can see, and the virus, in particular, Ebola, hepatitis C, HIV, HPV, flu, Japanese encephalitis, as all genes show mutation associated with susceptibility to this disorder. This because the role of HE3 ubiquitin ligase are very important, and as we demonstrated, that this class of enzymes are very important because are linked together to the spike protein of the virus. And this could be useful to facilitate the egress of the virus via lysosomal trafficking, in particular, two enzymes and therefore two genes, NIF4 and WWP1, were involved in this process. In fact, in the first studies, we were able to demonstrate that the people affected by COVID-19 show an elevated expression of these genes, and therefore the mRNA and the protein, in patients compared to controls for NIF4 and WWP1, but also for WWP2. We studied all genes involved in the family. Anyway, significant difference were observed only in these three particular genes. We were able to demonstrate the high level of expression of these genes also in a mouse model infected by SARS-CoV-2, and in particular in the lung of these mice, in which we localized the virus. We found in this same area very high level of this enzyme. This confirmed the previous data that we obtained in humans. And therefore, we just focused our attention in order to verify, are these two protein candidate targets for drugs in order to block the aggression of the virus. And this was tested in vitro using different inhibitors of NET4 and WWP1. And in particular, we will use the I3C. I3C is indolo-3-carbinolo. This is a drug, a natural product that is able to block the enzymatic activity of this enzyme. We tried infected cells and the virus cells treated with the SARS-CoV-2 untreated and treated with the drug I3C, the inhibitor of ubiquitin-free ligases, and we were able that the drug blocked the virus aggressors. This is an important result. Now we start to confirm, to extend the results also in animals and start with the clinical trials in humans. Therefore, we are now active in established protocol to obtain the authorization to start with the clinical trial with this new drug. And this is my last slide. And I would like to give what think Primo Levi, as Primo Levi is an Holocaust survivor. It's if understanding is impossible, knowing is imperative, because what happened could be happening again. Therefore, this is important for us to look at the functional properties of enzyme involved in the COVID-19 in order to open the route for the therapy. And thank you very much for your attention.